Let me think, water and naked actors. It was a cakewalk. When you are the department, communication's very fast and results are very fast. You end up with people doing something for a few weeks and it's like, oh, this is why I'm doing this, you know?
Hey, welcome back to another URSA Straps Behind the Scene. We're here in Montrose, California, this time with Dan McCoy.
Hey.
Thank Hi. Thank you for being with us.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, this is your lovely home. We're just enjoying your backyard, this gorgeous garden, and we're going to talk about Paddleton.
Let's do it.
Dan McCoy is a production sound mixer with over 20 years of passionate work in cinema and television sound. A proud IATSE and CAS member, he is renowned for his skill, innovation, and versatility in both the production and post-production processes. It would take the entire day to get through Dan's massive list of credits, which spans across formats, genres, and departments. So instead, we will focus on one specific chapter involving Dan's connection to the renegade filmmaking duo known as the Duplass Brothers. In this episode, we explore one film in particular that Dan mixed, which happens to be one of my favorite films of the past decade, Paddleton, directed by Alex Lehman and starring Ray Romano and Mark Duplass.
So you've worked with Mark and Jay Duplass a few times now.
A few times, yeah.
You're kind of like becoming their guy. It's great.
I like being called to work with them. I enjoy them very much.
I've been a big fan of theirs for years.
Right on.
I love, yeah, cool. I love the way they work. I love their writing style. They've also done so many different things, which I also, you know, hope for my own career. So I really followed them for years. And
that's beautiful.
I would love to know what you've observed about their filmmaking style that makes them as unique as they are.
Wow. I mean, I fell in love with their work. Then I saw Togetherness. And I really thought, man, that is a phenomenal show.
What a great series.
I got a call to go do one of their first commercials they were doing for an Australian company. And I really enjoyed working with them. And that turned into another thing. And before I knew it, I was back on set with the guys. When you strip away everything and it's just you and another couple crew members, the overlap of everyone's ability to help one another instantly becomes so transparent and so necessary that for me, it's like going back to being in a band or being in a small platoon of guerrilla filmmakers where, you know, you have a mission and you only have a few people, but you can help with resources when you're a small footprint too.
Absolutely.
It's funny to see big shows. I get on a big set with hundreds of crew and it's
lots of protocol, lots of
red tape and waiting and decisions that have to take days to be made. Whereas when you are the department, communication's very fast and
very easy.
Results are very fast too. So
what are the parameters you're working with on this project?
So this project was pretty intensely framed as a doc. You know, it was we had Nate, our DP, and another operator. And Nate operates them, and it was two ACs, Alex and Greg, who I've been fortunate enough to work with many times since. And Armando and a couple grip and electric, and that was the crew. And it was like, we want to shoot this thing in 18 days in solving. All the locations are within like 3 square miles. Mm-hmm. We're going to take over this hotel and this apartment and this doctor's office. And those were the parameters. Hey, we've got a 35-page outline, and we're going to shoot this 2-hour, hour-and-a-half-long film. And about 3 weeks.
Wow. And you were working with some brilliant improvisers. I mean, the type of improvising both Mark and Ray are so good at is this, there's a subtlety to it. It's not over the top. It's like, sometimes you can't tell, like, is he improvising? Is he just riffing? Like, is this written?
I was just remembering that this is the first project. Bo Brink from DPA sent me the first core edition of the 4060. And the 4061, I had one white one and one black one, and I put them on Ray and Mark for this entire feature. They all always had a 4060, same location, strapped themselves in. Pre-COVID, they knew how to do their own URSA body packs
with
the WYSICOM, but it was This was the first 4060, if I remember correctly, Bill telling me, in North America.
Wow.
And it translated beautifully. I just blew my mind off. The noise floor was like substantially lower.
That's beautiful.
Of an already really, to my ear, a perfect lavalier.
Paddleton is a lot of firsts. So we had the first, the core, the 4060.
Yep.
The first Super Zooka.
That was the first one, Eric helped me build.
Oh my gosh.
Yep.
It was interesting to hear that it's like you envisioned it. Mm-hmm. You pictured exactly what you needed, the height, the size, something that you can just wheel on set, park, and then wireless boom. Right.
Exactly. I knew the pacing of these projects with the Duplass brothers and the crew and Mel Estlin, who was producing this. And I knew I would be more effective as a boom op without a cinema bag on my belly while I was kind of trying to dance with two cameras and go through heavily improvised scenes. So I thought, man, what if I just had something I could pull next to Village, which was always a wall away or outside of the frame. I wanted something that had the right elevation and the right mobility that I could just eyeball my meters, make sure I was recording, jump back in the scene.
Yeah.
I was using on this film the Sonosax S4 Plus because I wanted a really lightweight, small footprint. Yeah. And I love the sound of that machine.
Amazing.
It's a really beautiful sounding machine.
Yeah.
And Mark and Ray were very consistent with their levels.
That's nice.
The rehearsals and the action, the actual take, rarely varied as far as their levels, because they're just such meticulous, talented actors. Mm-hmm. They really know, they're aware of the camera and what the sound department and what the lighting department's doing. So
how refreshing.
It really is. And they look out to the rest of the crew as part of the cast infrastructure to kind of make them look and sound better.
And like you said, Duplass sometimes won't close down a whole hotel, so there's still action. And
absolutely.
That's kind of a challenge.
It is. It is. And it makes it, it adds a background noise of energy to the process where you get more of that doc urgency of like, hey, I got to get this take, or, you know, real world is happening with narrative world, and it creates a fusion that's remarkably noticeable in some of the urgency in some of the moments that I really appreciate.
I like that you made that work for you, though, you know, because some people will stress out so hard over, you know, we have to wait till it's all clear and we have to do this and, you know, treating a room like crazy. And not that there's anything wrong with those.
There isn't. Those are wonderful,
absolutely
wonderful protocols. And I believe me, every time I can do that, I do.
Me too.
But when you're an army of one and you have a limited amount of time and resources, relying on your front end technology to give you the ultimate dynamic range and frequency response gives you an edge up on that background noise and those far off distant noise issues where I've always said this, but having used the DPA for so many years and systems from Electro and Visicom, you're able to offset those challenges because you're just getting more information in that intelligibility spectrum of the actor's voice that other systems, I don't hear that same result. A lot of times I didn't even use a mask or aerials because we were able to get so intimate and close in.
Oh, that's nice.
So just whips on the WYSICOM would go AES out.
Mm-hmm.
So it stayed 48 kilohertz into the Sonosax.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, I was multi-tracking lavs, wireless boom, and a mix on top of that in a polyphonic file that I could also bring up on my phone through their Wi-Fi protocol and control and label.
Okay,
Sonosax has a really cool Wi-Fi.
They do, a wingman or something.
It's like that, but it's actually Wi-Fi, which is really nice. It's a little bit more, the range is a little bit better than Bluetooth, and it's a little bit more metadata to control and manipulate.
That's really cool.
You can put it on an iPad, any browser you can dial into this interface. And so I like that I could have a little device, a confidence that I was rolling.
Yeah.
But it's a dual card record, and I think I had a 633 as backup off the cart, kind of inside the bag.
I was about to ask what was in the bag. Yeah,
the bag inside, well, so there was an Orca bag on top that had three SR, three MCR42s, and electro transmitter for our hop and our IFBs for producers and director. And I never really used more than six wires because of you know, even with the wireless boom, two primary, a third actor coming in and a couple plants, I was covered with six channels.
That's beautiful.
And the Sonosax is nice because there's no limiter or compressor because it has two A to D converters. So the input stage is 132 or 136 dB dynamic range. So if one A to D gets saturated, it goes to the next.
Yeah, so you had a pretty minimal setup. I mean, the picture you showed me, it looked like you could just put it in a car.
And that's
put
what
it
we
in
did.
Truck.
That's what I did. I never used any grip. I'm sorry, I never used any stake beds. Everything was in my trunk and out my trunk each day, or
that's
in the closet, out the closet. And even when we did some of those field scenes outside in that giant abandoned drive-in theater or the ostrich farm, I was able to wheel the cart anywhere with a single hand. Mm. One hand on the boom, one hand rolling the Super Zooka.
And this is why I am also getting a Super Zooka. Shout out to Eric Ballou at Cannibal Industries who makes these things along with you.
Yes.
You're a partner
Absolutely.
In this as well, right?
Yeah,
these
course.
Are such great little carts. And I can only imagine holding the boom in so many scenarios where, like, I'm sure you experience this on this set, but there's been so many times where it's been so brilliant what's happening, the improvising. I just want to laugh. It's like, it's killing me.
Yeah, yeah. Weeping's quiet. So we all can weep in a lot of these very emotional scenes.
Right, but laughing, you got to hold that in.
You definitely have to put the kibosh on it, seal the lips. But I remember distinctly, like, the final scene of the film when Mark is passing, that every crew member was weeping while we were making the film. A friend was dying with us, you know.
That's special.
We had done 2-3 weeks, lived with these characters, and it was very emotional. I still get a little emotional.
I can see that. You're making me feel
verklempt. Very real. It was very real.
Oh, and that's so beautiful.
And when we went to Sundance with the film, and everyone was bawling in the theater, I thought, okay,
it worked. We captured it.
It did. We did our job.
Yeah.
So that was. Yeah. Not a lot of moments in your career where you can say that, where you capture emotion and then it's delivered and it translated. Like, you're like, oh my, it's like discovering the Rosetta Stone. It's like, yes, this is what it's about, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah.
I always get choked up about this stuff because
you
know, it's funny, you can spend 20 years, 30 years in your career and you end up with people doing something for a few weeks, and it's like, that epiphany of, this is why I'm doing this, you know?
Speaking of precious moments,
yes.
I'd love to get into this scene a little bit.
Let's dive in.
Let's dive into the jacuzzi.
What? Yeah. Yeah. I'll fucking do it.
Oh.
That's hot.
I love it. I love it.
This is one of the scenes that stands out to me dialogue-wise.
Oh,
you know, there's
cool.
there's an Ray Romano's character is just so exposed in this scene because, you know, even I remember there's a scene where Mark takes his hat and runs off, and even that he felt a little like, oh my God, what just happened? You know, and now he's almost fully naked in a jacuzzi, and here comes this very, very, you know, what's
sensual.
The word for her?
Sensual,
very, she's coming on strong. You know, she's a woman who knows what she wants.
Yes, and she's comfortable in her skin, and he is not.
Exactly. So, I mean, this is a really powerful scene. What were some of the challenges you were facing working on this scene?
Let me think. Water and naked actors, not much.
No,
not
super
much.
Easy.
It was a cakewalk. And I don't think, I might be mistaken, but in this film, in this scene, almost nothing is replaced.
Ooh.
So it's all their takes.
That's great.
And we achieved that with some really nice plant mics,
yeah.
and we can talk about that later too. It was two shotguns, and then when we rotated, I'd move those shotguns over. I had them static, so I could kind of blend.
Yeah,
exactly.
Absolutely.
Lens perspective, and the 4017s were great, but they were getting a little too much water, so I used an AKG inference tube, which is basically like an 816, like a Sennheiser.
I was going to say, yeah. When you did this, crazy. I was
I mean,
they were like,
to get that ultra, ultra narrow pickup pattern.
I've never used one of those mics.
Just around the forehead so it'd get off the water and the bubbles, because we didn't kill the jets at all. We kept the jets full going.
They do look like they're running the entire time.
The entire scene, back and forth,
Oh my gosh. And here comes our gal. Yep. She gets right in.
Yes, she does.
And something that, there's moments of this scene, it's very silence heavy in some places. Like you're really playing with that kind of awkward tension, you know, like who's gonna say something.
The bubbles start to rise,
You guys are so adorable, you know that? I mean, like from the very first moment when you checked in, we could really feel that you were totally in love. It was really sweet.
Oh no.
It's an intense moment, and it's very, like you said, it's very vulnerable, very emotional, and these actors were champs. It was probably 32, 35 degrees outside. It was the coldest winter in Solvang.
Hope it was warm in there.
It was. We kept it a good 95.
Ooh, God.
But there's a few scenes where they jump in and out of the hot tub, and we were all in parkas, just out of frame. Mm. So there's a DPA between them.
Under the clothes pile.
Exactly.
Brilliant.
And that's right at the edge of the cement. And I tried to shift those a little where the camera angle shifted. So it's in frame. But obviously they're not talking over that really. That's just kind of getting atmosphere. So I would use these shotguns point on. And I got the shotgun idea from Sean, who is the mixer on Mandalorian. She was using
Sean Holden was using
these. They're 451s, but I think they're 481s. They're modified, and then they have these really incredible capsules where you can do a short shotgun indoors, and you can add another interference tube to get that hyper super lobe. So it's almost an 816 length.
Perfect for a situation like
for this.
It was. Yeah.
I have pictures I'll share with you
of
these giant naked shotguns. Yeah. I think sometimes I'd have the foam, and sometimes I'd pull the foam because...
Wow.
Thankfully, it wasn't a windy night.
Exactly.
It was no wind that night, so I could get away with. And I like to do that. I like to pull foam and fur whenever possible, indoor, outdoor.
Yep.
As long as there isn't a draft or a wind, I don't need my wind protection.
Just get as close as you can, close to the source as you can. Absolutely.
Close to the source. Let that transducer get as much sound pressure.
Yep.
Untouched by fur.
Absolutely. Oh, and here he goes. Mark is heading to bed here. So subtle.
He took a cue.
Subtle.
He's trying to give him the cue too.
I don't have a key though. I don't have a key.
It's okay. I get a lot of keys.
You got a lot of them in the.
Ray is very chest heavy in his voice. His vibrato.
Very deep voice.
Very deep.
Absolutely.
Very in that register. So with the bubbles and stuff and his. He was kind of embarrassed, so he was often not giving the full, but he still, his low end was radiating enough where you could hear that lower mid-range in his voice, which was nice. These lobes were so tight, even cueing, you didn't want to really cue that much. It was just fractional cueing, because if you did that, you would get completely different coloration of the background noise, because they're so tight.
Gosh.
But yeah, this was a really, it translated shockingly well. I was really happy with the results, with all the water and the bubbles and the quietness.
It's so intimate. Yeah, exactly. Oh my gosh.
No, that's okay. That's all right. That's all right.
You guys, I see, did a lot of driving for this.
We did.
Process trailer, Biscuit.
I wish I could tell you it was that easy. It was all in camera.
Wow.
Camera in car.
Really?
It was follow. We had no process trailer. We had no Biscuit.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it was. I was really excited with the range we got out there because at the time, it was wide open. There wasn't really any DTV or RF interference. So Alex would monitor their dialogue with a walkie from a car, four car lengths, five car lengths behind.
So usually it was the two of them in the front seat, and then who would be in the back seat?
Just Nate, just the DP, single camera.
When I think of this movie, a few scenes really stand out to me. Mm. One of them is that scene in the hotel lobby where they're just screaming at each other.
Yeah.
Because they're both so reserved. Mm-hmm. There's almost an air of each character that they're like a taut rubber band.
Mm.
You know,
yeah,
and this
I
is like, they just let it out.
Snap.
And it's so cathartic, even as a viewer, to watch that scene. So hey, let's go to that scene real quick.
Sure. Hey. What are you over here?
Yeah, I'm just looking at the fire. I was waiting for you to get up. I thought we'd get some, you know, pancakes.
Are you watching fire?
Yeah, you ever just watch a fire?
Yeah.
Yeah, so nice.
Yeah, you should have walked me though, you know?
What?
So, in this scene, this is another practical location. You don't have the whole thing closed off, shut down.
No,
you're working with real life.
We basically, if I recall correctly, we only had like the lobby and a room. So the hotel was still open and going. They gave us the lobby like for a 6 hour or 4 hour segment. So,
must have scared the shit out of some
man,
people.
They
with
were full. We had people walking by, looking in the window,
yeah.
and like going. We were trying to. We're not open right now.
Right, yeah.
It's amazing when you're at a hotel, like they don't really look at close signs when you're living there overnight.
Right.
So we had a nice AD department shelter them on through. But this is the actual lobby during business hours.
It's mine.
Just give it to me and we don't.
What are you doing? What are you doing? I'm like, I'm going to hold it.
It's you're running away from me? I'm just give me the.
What are you chasing me? You're chasing me.
I'm not chasing you.
Well, stop moving then. Stop moving around the table. Stop moving. All right, just stop it, all right?
I'm not.
This is stupid.
Andy,
I got the bad knee.
You know I got the bad knee. You know I'm gonna catch you if you want me to catch you.
All right, you better stop. I'm gonna tell you right now.
Andy.
I won't stop.
They were running and chasing each other and sweating and
you can
swearing.
See it. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You hear all of that too
the
in the dialogue. Yeah. I like that nobody tried to control that or go like, oh, let's get a clean take of the dialogue. No, you want to hear them suffering and sweating.
It is in that respect a very accurate documentary of what the actors were doing and feeling.
And it just escalates too, I feel like. It gets louder and louder and louder. You know, you being a one-man band-ish team at that point, that's always something that I look out for when people get loud. That's hard to deal with as a one-person team.
It is, especially when you're not at the console. And so you've got to really rely on your mics
DPA
and your limiters
and
really hope for the best. And when you have the opportunity to work with an actor who gives you these great performances and shows you what they do volume-wise, in this case, I was able to really kind of set their lav level lower because I knew there'd be an extreme. And then I was able to keep my boom consistent because I could cue it and adjust analogously with the boom, with proximity. So I can, in real time, pull off a little bit, cue off a little bit to avoid any kind of clipping. So to mitigate that, you know, you want microphones that
can handle it.
Yeah. The human voice won't clip a DPA.
Yeah, you can put one of those DPAs on a trumpet.
Yeah.
I think we're okay with the human voice.
Exactly, verbatim. And then you just, you figure out your gain stage based on what the actors give you volume-wise. And as I said, I can ride the lavs a little lower. Mm. And I can actually get the boom in there where I need it and dance in real time based on where they're going. Because, you know, oftentimes if I'm booming, I'll have one ear in real time open to the actor.
I do that too.
And one ear with the delay of the processing and so I can
so
hear distortion
helpful.
if I have it.
Yeah.
But, you can get a real strong sense of, oh, this is, I can feel the sound pressure building in the room. I know I got to come down a little bit and back off of it.
I don't know why you're making a big deal out of it.
Because I'm the dying guy. I'm the dying guy.
Okay, all right. You can't keep saying that.
But you keep taking that. I'm the dying
guy. All right, shut up with that.
Then give me the safe.
You're being a stupid idiot right now.
I'm the dying guy. Give me
shut
the
up.
Safe. I'm the dying guy.
I know you're the dying guy. Stop saying
I'm
it.
The dying guy.
I'm the other guy.
When you've prepped properly and you've brought in gear that you know well and is tried and true, the chances of a catastrophe are very mitigated. They're very small.
Yeah.
Which is why also I love to boom and wire because you can play those two in your favor to save the best performance for post. But Post was very happy with this film.
That's great.
They got some very remarkable tracks, and I think the ADR, from what I remember, was very, very low.
That's great.
A few lines.
All around sound as a whole, when you put those together, the production sound, the post sound, the music, it really created a very special world.
Oh, I'm so glad you got that.
Well done.
Yeah. Oh, beautiful. Yeah. I salute the team.
It was
just an honor to be part of it.
This is a good one. I'm so glad we got to talk to you about
My
this.
My pleasure, anytime.
Thank you.
A big thanks to Dan McCoy for taking the time to join us and break down these scenes, and another very special thank you to Tom Caltabiano for providing some great behind-the-scenes still photos. Be sure to like the video, subscribe to the channel, and look out for more great content from URSA. This is Kim Kyland, signing off. Thanks for watching.